Well, I briefly want to introduce myself. I'm managing director of German Orchestra Union, and I studied law and organ, which means I'm a lawyer and a musician. And I just want to announce that you will have vouchers out there for the digital concert hall of the Berlin Phil. And if they are out, I give you new ones, because you can experience it on a 24 hours free voucher, and then experience it and say it's thumbs up or thumbs down. By the way, this leads me to the issue, the last issue of this day, visionary orchestra management. I like this issue very much because we can put everything we want to talk on orchestras now. And I'm very happy that I have such a prestigious podium sitting here, and we will have three sides. We will have the side from Asia, from China, and I'm very happy to say hello to Mrs. Guo Shang, which is the president of the China Symphony Development Foundation, as well as the head of the Asian Pacific Orchestra Summit. So she is very well informed about the Asian situation of orchestras. And next to her you will find Roger Wright, who is the director, is written director, but I think he's a controller of BBC, is the right term, controller of BBC, responsible for the program as well as for the BBC proms. Next to him is Alan Valentine, president and CEO from the Nashville Symphony in US state Tennessee. And next to him, you will find Bruce Rich, chairman of AFM IXOM from the US. So we will have three perspectives: the Asian perspective, the UK European perspective, and the US perspective. And I think this will be a very interesting session. And we will do it in the order that is written in the program. So please, Alan, take the floor for your contribution.
Thank you, Jared. Before I begin, I want to say thank you to you all for inviting me here today. I've been managing orchestras now for about 30 years, but before that, before I went to the dark side and became a stand-up comedian, I actually was a musician, so I tell people I'm a recovering percussionist. And of course, my wife loves to tell people that if it weren't for her, I would be homeless. Which is the case for most percussionists, of course. The Nashville Symphony, and I'm going to talk about, paint a snapshot here for just a moment to help frame what I'm about to say in terms of some points that I think we need to think about as we find our way to move forward together. And I agree with very much with what has been said here today about the nature of this problem being our collective problem, it's not an us and them kind of issue. The Nashville Symphony, the orchestra that I'm with, 13 years ago in 1998, I'm just going to give you some quick facts. It had a budget of about $6 million U.S. Per year. It had 55 only full-time musicians in the orchestra, and the salaries were abysmal. It had 20 staff, no concert hall, lived out of the back of a truck, and the total assets of the organization were about $6 million. You fast forward to today, and the orchestra has a $23 million budget, 83 full-time musicians. Their salaries are 2.5 times what they were 13 years ago. There are a total of 55 staff for the orchestra and another 40 for the hall. We built and own, and I can answer that question from our friends from Norway a little bit later in terms of my perspective, but we built and own a $140 million fantastic concert hall. And we have total assets of $220 million, and $100 million of that are net assets. That is after you strip out the building and the debt on the building. So the question is, you know, how did this happen? What are the key things that happened during the last 13 years to propel the Nashville Symphony into what is called Group One orchestras in the U.S.? It was a pretty sleepy regional orchestra until then. There are several points. We got the internal culture right. The very first thing that had to happen was that the internal culture, which was very unhealthy at the time, had to be changed, and it was changed through a series of both retreats with the staff, as well as a lot of discussion with the musicians, and ultimately a number of the staff and had to be replaced. And even on the board of directors, we found ourselves having to replace some board members and bring some new people in. The very second thing, and this has been talked about today as well, we developed a very comprehensive, compelling, and clear strategic plan for the orchestra. The hall was part of that plan, but the plan really focused on building the quality of the orchestra in a way that would capture the imagination of the community. I think earlier my colleague from Dallas talked about how important it was to have a good case for support when you're raising money. So we had a compelling plan, and it was shared by everyone in the institution. Not just the staff or the board, but also the musicians, the volunteers, and a number of the key constituents like, you know, representatives from our subscriber base. Third, we put our focus clearly on our artistic vision. We had already, just because of what we had been doing, developed something of a reputation for the performance of American music, especially contemporary American music. And we sort of formalized that and really decided that one of the keys to our success as we move forward as part of this plan was to really distinguish ourselves from our colleagues by creating a niche for ourselves in the market that included this focus on American music and in terms of our recordings and in terms of our programming. That was also a commitment, by the way, to composers. We heard about that earlier. Fourth, we really began to focus on how we could become more relevant to the community. We've talked about that all day today, but in our case, that meant a number of things. First, we decided that anytime anything happened in Nashville or the surrounding region in which music could play a key role, we wanted to be in the middle of it. You know, Nashville is Music City, USA. Obviously, we have country artists, we have all of the you know, there's a concentration of studios in Nashville that is actually greater than the concentration of studios in either LA or New York. Most recording activity in the US actually happens in Nashville. But we decided that we wanted to be in the middle of all of those events. So just to give you an example, when the NFL football team, the Tennessee Titans, opened the new stadium, the orchestra was on the 50-yard line of the football field playing the national anthem and a special fanfare we had composed for the occasion. When the new library opened, we were there. Anytime there was a celebration in the community, we wanted the orchestra to provide the music. We also stepped up our efforts in terms of education and community engagement activities. In particular, we did something not a lot of orchestras do. We actually began, instead of just playing concerts and going into schools and talking about music, we actually began teaching applied music. Now, those wasn't done as services of the orchestra, but we raised the money to pay musicians to actually begin teaching music in collaboration with a community music school. Relevance, in terms of relevance to society, the hall was a centerpiece of our effort. We created, though, a group of people called the Nashville Advisory Council for the new concert hall. And this was a group of people who represented every facet of life in the community, not just the traditional community leaders. And their role was to become emissaries to the rest of the community about the work we were doing. And it was so successful that we ended up with three times as many people involved in that effort as possible. So, as we think about how we move forward, our experience shows that there are the key things that we need are creativity and innovation. We're creative institutions. We need to look at the possibilities rather than the obstacles in our way. If we look at the obstacles in our way, we're going to hit them. But if we look past the obstacles, we'll move past them. And, you know, we obviously have to deal with them. But the analogy I would use is I like to ride motorcycles. And on a motorcycle, anybody that rides a motorcycle knows that if you look right in front of you, you're going to actually have problems. But if you look way down the road at where you're going, the motorcycle will go there. And it's really very true. So, our experience is that we have to become innovative, creative. We have to step up our programming, not retreat in these difficult times. Step up the service that we deliver to the community. And that's not to say our efforts were without challenges. We do have challenges. We had a flood, $40 million flood. But we recovered from it because we built a resilient organization filled with the right people. We have challenges today with the banking community in terms of the debt on the building. But we're dealing effectively with those challenges because we have the right people, and we have a lot of creativity and innovation in our institution. So I think those are the solutions for how we move forward in our experience.